way that we keep going is by your donations. So if you could, at the end of the show, a lot of the actors will be walking around with hats and baskets and things, and whatever you could give would be greatly appreciated. A few thanks to people. I'd like to thank Betsy Huesmeyer, who's our executive director at The Beacon, Carla Arsenault, who is my stage manager, Dennis and Linda Bradley, who helped with set pieces and costumes, Ray West, who is the manager of the Beacon Thrift Store. I walked in the other day. I go in there and get set pieces and props and things like that. I walked in the other day, and as soon as I walked in the door, he said, "No, get out, you can't have anything else." So, I'd like to thank Ellie, who's in the audience tonight, for helping sew a lot of the costumes that you'll see tonight. We pretty much built all the dresses from scratch, so that was an excellent help, so thank you, Ellie. You can silence all your cell phones. I greatly appreciate it. You can take pictures. I wrote play, so there's no copyright issues or anything with that. We'll have a brief intermission after the third scene. So the house lights will come up. You guys can get up. The bathrooms are in the back, and there's a water fountain back there as well. But sit back, relax, and enjoy the Christmas Carol.
Thank you.
Marley was dead to begin with. There is no doubt whatever about that. Old Marley was as dead as a doornail. Mind, I don't mean to say that I know of my own knowledge what there is particularly dead about a doornail. I might have been inclined myself to regard a coffin nail as the deadest piece of ironmongery in the trade. But the wisdom of our ancestors is in the simile, and my unhallowed hands shall not disturb it, or the country's done for. You will therefore permit me to repeat emphatically that Marley was as dead as a doornail. Scrooge knew he was dead? Of course he did. How could it be otherwise? Scrooge and he were partners for I don't know how many years. Scrooge never painted out Marley's name. There it stood, years afterwards, above the warehouse door. Scrooge and Marley. Oh, but he was a tight-fisted hand at the grindstone, Scrooge. A squeezing, wrenching, grasping, scraping, clutching, covetous old sinner. Hard and sharp as flint, from which no steel had ever struck out generous fire. Secret and self-contained, and solitary as an oyster.
Say, God bless it.
Let me hear another sound from you, and you'll keep your Christmas by losing your situation. Quite a powerful speaker, sir. I wonder you don't go into Parliament.
Come here. Come. Dine with us tomorrow.
I will see you. I will see you in that extremity first.
But why? Why?
Why did you get married?
Because I fell in love.
Yes, you fell in love. Good afternoon.
Nay, Uncle. Nay, but you never came to see me before that happened.
Good
I used it for a reason to not come out. I'm sorry, all my life, to find you so late. But I've made this trial an homage to Christmas, and I need to keep my Christmas human to the last. So, a Merry Christmas, Uncle.
Good afternoon!
And a Happy New Year!
Good afternoon!
Merry Christmas.
There's another fellow. My flock. With 15 shillings a week. And a wife and family.
Talking about a Merry Christmas.
I'll be tired for sure.
Scrooge Marley's, I believe. Have we the pleasure of addressing Mr. Scrooge for Mr. Morris?
Mr. Marley has been dead these 7 years. He died 7 years ago on this very night.
We have no doubt that his liberality is well represented by his surviving work. At this festive season of the year, Mr. Scrooge, is more than usually desirable that we should make things like provisions for the poor and destitute, who suffer greatly at the present time. Many thousands are in want of common necessaries. Hundreds of thousands are in want of common comforts, sir.
Well, there are no prisons.
Plenty of prisons.
And the union workhouses, are they in operation?
They are. Still, I wish I could say they were not.
The treadmill and the poor law are bigger.
Both very busy, sir.
Oh, I thought from what you had said at first that something had occurred to stop them from operating in their useful course. I'm very glad to hear it.
Thank you. Eternity, before the good of which it is susceptible is all developed. Not to know that all spirits working in their own kindly little sphere, whatever that may be, should find their mortal lives too short for vast means of usefulness. Not to know that no space of regret can make amends for one's life opportunity misused. Yet, such was I. Oh, such was I.
But you were always a good man of business.
Business? Mankind was my business. The common welfare my business. Charity, mercy, forbearance, benevolence, they were all my businesses. My trade was but a drop of water in the comprehensive ocean of my business. At this time of the rolling year, I suffer most. Why did I walk through the crowds of my fellow man with my eyes turned down? Hear me! My time is nearly gone.
I will, but don't be hard upon me. Don't be flowery, Jacob Bray.
How it is I appear to you in a shape that you can see, not tell. I have sat beside you invisible many, many a day. It is no kind penance that I have to do. I am here tonight to warn you that you have yet a chance and a hope of escaping my fate. A chance and a hope of my procuring Ebenezer.
You are always a good friend to me. Thank you.
You will be haunted by three spirits.
Is that the chance and hope you mentioned, Jacob?
It is.
Oh, I think I'd rather not.
Without their visits, you cannot hope to shun the path I tread. Expect the first tomorrow, when the bell tolls one.
Couldn't I take them all at once and have it over, Jacob?
Expect the second upon the next night of the same hour. And the third upon the next night, when the last stroke of 12 has ceased to vibrate. Look to see me no more, Ebenezer, and look that for your own sake. You remember what has passed between us.
mom, whose coming was foretold to me.
I am.
Who and what are you?
I am the ghost of Christmas past.
Long past?
No, your past.
What business brings you here?
Your welfare. Rise and walk with me.
Happiness he gives. is every bit as great as it cost a fortune.
What is the matter?
Nothing in particular.
Something, I think.
No. I should like to be able to say a word or two to my clerk just now. That is all.
My time grows short. Quick!
This is the even hand dealing of the world, and there is nothing on which it is so hard as poverty, and there is nothing it professes to condemn with such severity as the pursuit of wealth.
You fear the world too much. All your hopes have merged into the hope of you beyond the chance of its sordid reproach. I have seen you know where aspirations fall off one by one until the master passion, gain, engrosses you, have I not?
What then? Even if I've grown so much wiser, what then? I have not changed towards you, am I?
Our contract was no one. It was made in your local court. We intend to be so until a good season. We can improve our worldly fortune with our patient industry. You are changed. You were another man when it was made.
I was a boy.
Your own feeling tells you you are not what you are. I am, which promised happiness when we were one in heart. Sprout with misery now that we are two. How often and how keenly I thought of this, I will not say. It is enough that I have thought of it.
Have I ever sought release?
In words. No, never.
In what then?
In a changed nature, an altered spirit, another atmosphere, another hope at its great end. Anything that made my love and me forgotten in your sight. This had never been between us. Would you try to seek me out and win me now? No.
You think not?
I would gladly think otherwise if I could. Heaven knows when I've learned a truth like this, I know how strong yours is fought. But if you were free today, tomorrow, yesterday, can even I believe that you would choose a doubtless world? You, who in your very confidence would prove away everything by gain, were choosing her with your one false and principle to do so. Do I not know repentance and regret will surely follow? I do. And I release you with the full heart of love to him who owns her.
But
you may. The memory of those past have mixed me with will. A painless. A very, very great time. I dismiss it with the recollection of it as an impossible dream in which you may awoke. Maybe half of the life of the chosen.
Spirit, show me no more. Conduct me home. Why do you delight to torture me?
One shadow more.
No more. I don't wish to see it. Show me no more.
I told you, lead to the shadows.
I'm afraid I have not. Do you have any brothers, Phil?
More than 1,800.
Oh, a tremendous family to provide for. Come talk to me where you will. I went forth on compulsion last night, and I learned a lesson that is working now. Tonight, if you have aught to teach me, let me profit by it.
Touch my robe.
Like this performance I give you Mr. Scrooge, the founder of our feast.
The founder of the feast, indeed. I wish I had him here. I gave him a piece of my mind to feast upon, and I hope he'd have a good appetite for it.
Darling, the children. It's Christmas Day.
It should be Christmas Day, on which one brings the help of such an odious, stingy, hard, unfeeling man like Mr. Scrooge. No one knows it better than you do, Robert.
My darling, Christmas Day.
I'll drink his health for your sake and the day's, not his. Long life to him, a Merry Christmas and a Happy New Year. He'll be very merry and very happy, I have no doubt.
Thank you.
us, but is life so short?
My life upon this globe is very brief. Next tonight.
Tonight?
Tonight at midnight. The time is drawing very near. Oh, man. Look. Down there.
Spirit. Are they yours?
They are men's. And they cling to me, appealing from their fathers. This boy is ignorance. The girl is want. Beware them both in all their degrees. But most of all, beware this boy. For on his brow there's a written, which is doom, unless the writing be erased. Tonight, slander does so tell me. Admit it for your factious purposes and make it worse. And abide the end.
Have they no refuge or resource?
Are there no prison? Are there no workhouses?
The night is waning fast, and it is precious time to me, I know. Lead on, Spirit.
No, I don't know much about it. Either way, I only know he's dead.
When did he die?
Last night, I believe.
Why? What was the matter?
Oh, God knows.
What has he done with his money?
I don't rightly know. Left it to his company, perhaps. He didn't leave it to me, that's all I know.
Enough. Who's the worst for the loss of a few items like these? Certainly not a dead man, I suppose.
No, indeed.
And he'd wanted to keep these things after he was dead. Wicked old screw. Why wasn't he natural in his lifetime? If he had been, he'd have had somebody there with him when he was struck with death, rather than lying and gasping out his last alone by himself.
No truer words were ever spoke.
It is a judgment on him. And I wish it were a little heavier judgment than it would have been, I can assure you, if I could have gotten my hands on anything else. Open the bundle, Joe, and tell me the value of it. Speak out plain. I'm not afraid to be the first, nor afraid for her to hear. We all know pretty well we were looking out for ourselves before we met here. It's no sin. Open the bundle, Joe.
Now let's let the laundress go first. I always give too much to the ladies. It's a weakness of mine and it'll ruin me. There's your account. Now, if you ask for a penny more, I'll repent of being so liberal and knock off half a crown.
And now open my bundle, Joe.
What are these? Bed curtains?
Ah, bed curtains.
You mean you took them down, rings and all, with him lying there?
Of course I do. And why not?
Oh, you were born to make a fortune, and you probably will.
Well, I certainly shan't hold my hand when I can get anything in you just by reaching them out, especially for the likes of one like him. Oh, Joe, don't get oil on that blanket now.
His blanket?
Who else's do you think? He's certainly not likely to catch cold without it now. Oh, don't worry yourself about that. I ain't so fond of his company to loiter about for such things if he had. Oh, you can look through that shirt till your eyes ache, and you won't find a hole in it, nor a threadbare place. It's the best he had, and a fine one, too. They'd have wasted it if it hadn't been for me.
What do you mean by wasting it?
Why, putting it on him to be buried in. Oh, somebody was fool enough to do it, but I took it off again. If Calico ain't good enough for such a purpose, he ain't good enough for anything. It's quite as becoming to the body, and he couldn't have looked worse in it than he did in that one. Ooh, and here's the end of it. He frightened everyone away from him when he was alive to profit us when he was dead.
I see. The case of this unhappy man might be that of my own. My life tends that way now. Merciful heaven! What is this? This is a fearful place, and in leaving it, I shall not leave its message. Trust me. Let us go. I understand you, and I wouldn't do it if I could, but I have not the power, Spirit. If there is any person in the town who feels emotion caused by this man's death, show that person to me. Show me someone who has some emotion at her death, for this dark chamber will be forever present to me. Thank you.
Scrooge's nephew today. He noticed I was a little down, you know? And so he inquired as to what had happened to distress me so. To which, for he is the most pleasant-spoken gentleman I have ever heard, I told him, I am heartily sorry, he said, Mr. Cratchit, and heartily sorry for your good wife. By the by, how he knew that, I will never know.
Knew what, dear?
Why, that you were a good wife.
Everybody knows that.
Very well observed, my boy. You know, I hope they do. Heartily sorry for this. For your good wife. If I could be of service to you anywhere, he said, handing me his glove. This is where I live. Pray, come to me. Now, it wasn't so much for what he could do for us, as his kind way that this was really delightful. It seemed as if he really knew our tiny tin and felt with us.
I'm sure he's a good soul.
Oh, you would be more sure of it, my dear, if you saw and spoke to him. I wouldn't be at all surprised, not what I say. If he got Peter here, in a better position.
Only hear that, Peter. And then, Peter will be keeping company with someone setting up for himself.
Get along, Peter.
It's just as likely as not. These days, but there's plenty of time for that. But, however, we do part from one another. I'm sure that you and I shall forget the word I need to, shall we? Nor this, our first part of the lesson. And I know, when we recollect how patient and how mild he was, although he was a little child, we shall not easily quarrel amongst ourselves and forget the time to enjoy.
No, never, Father.
I'm very happy. I'm very happy.
Inspector, something informs me that our parting moment is at hand. I know it. I know not how. Tell me who that man was we saw lying dead. These courts, in which we hurry now, is where my place of occupation is, and has been for a length of time. I see the house. Let me behold what I shall be in days to come. The house lies yonder. Why do you find your way? Men's courses foreshadow certain ends to which, if persevering, they must lead. But if the courses are departed from, the ends will change. Say it is thus with what you show me. Am I that man who lay upon the bed? No, spirit, hear me. I am not the man at once. I will not be the man I was to have been before this intercourse. Why show me this, even I am past all hope? Good spirit, your nature intercedes and fitters me. See if I have more chance. See if I have a better chance. Good spirit, please, see if some has found your way. I shall live in the past, the present, and the future. The spirit of all three shall strive within me. Oh, Jacob, heaven and the Christmas time be praised for this. I say it on my knees, oh, Jacob, on my knees. They are not torn down. They are not torn down. Rings and all, they are here. I am here. The shadows of the things are may be dispelled. They will. I know they will. I don't know what to do. I feel as light as a feather, as happy as an angel, as merry as a schoolboy, as giddy as a drunken man. A Merry Christmas to everyone! A Happy New Year to all the world! It all happened!
Thank you. tell you what,
my friend. I'm not going to stand for this sort of thing any longer. And therefore, I am about to raise your salary. A Merry Christmas, Bob. A Merry Christmas, Bob, my fellow, that I've given you many a year. I'll raise your salary, and I'll endeavor to assist in your struggling family.
Oh, Mr. Scrooge, thank you. Merry Christmas. It was you then, Mr. Turtle.
It was, Mr. Cratchit. I hope that we may all share it together.
Of course, please, do come in.
My darlings, let me introduce you to the founder of our feast, Mr. Scrooge.
Blesses everyone.
Thank you.